So in the last video, we built a JK flip-flop that didn't work all that well. We used an RC circuit to detect the rising edge of the clock, but because the JK flip-flop toggled so quickly, we encountered this racing phenomenon where it would toggle many times for each clock pulse. And we found it was really difficult to fix, you know, almost impossible to fix on a breadboard to get that clock pulse to be so short, you know, the pulse that we're generating with the RC circuit from the rising edge of the clock, to get that to be so short that we would only toggle once. We found that it was almost impossible to get that working robustly on a breadboard. So what can we do? Well, there's another way to build a JK flip-flop, and that's this circuit here, which is called a master-slave JK flip-flop. And so what you'll see if you look at this is you see there's two SR latches built into this. There's one here and then one here. And you know, you can think of this as having, you know, your set and your reset. And in this case, this will be the Q complement and this will be the Q output. And then over here, you know, this will be the reset and the set. And then this is our Q output and our complement Q. So these are these two SR latches, which you know, you can look at my previous video on those. But then outside of that, you have these AND gates that are essentially gating the clock, or gating the SR latch based on the clock. So for the moment, let's ignore these feedbacks. We'll get to that in a minute. But if you look at just these two inputs of the AND gate, the J input and then the clock, or in this case, the K input and the clock, basically what we're saying this SR latch is not going to be active unless the clock is high. So when the clock is high, then, you know, J will pass through and set, or K will pass through and reset anytime the clock is high. So this is just sort of like a, you know, an SR latch with an enable, if you want to think of the clock in that way. And then same thing if you look at the slave over here. In the slave side, you've got an SR latch as well. The inputs are coming from the master, but then instead of the clock input coming into these AND gates, you've got the inverted clock input. And so the slave is only going to be active when the clock is low. And so the interesting piece of this is that you're never going to have a situation where both of these SR latches are active at the same time, because the clock is either going to be high, in which case this one's active, or the clock is going to be low, in which case this one is active. And so if you want to set this flip-flop, you want to get the Q output to be high, then you bring J high, and then you toggle the clock high and low. And so with J high, when the clock goes high, then it's going to set the first latch. And so the Q output of that first latch is going to go high. Then when the clock goes low, that enables the second latch, and that Q output gets fed through and sets the second latch, which causes this Q output to go high. So you can see setting the J input, toggling the clock high, then low, causes the Q to get set. And then the same way with K, if you set K high and then you toggle the clock high, then low, then it resets this latch. And then when the clock goes low, it resets this latch, which resets the output, so sets Q to zero. So effectively, it's kind of a two-step process where the clock has to go high, then low. Now, what about, you know, this is a JK flip-flop, so we should have that property where if J and K are both high, then the output should toggle each time the clock pulses. So in that case, if J and K are both high, when the clock goes high, the first latch is either going to set or reset depending on what the current output is. So if the current output is that Q is high, then it's going to come around here and this AND gate is going to turn on and it's going to reset. But if the current output is low and then the complement output is high, then this is going to come around and the top AND gate is going to turn on and it's going to set. So essentially this first latch will output on this Q the opposite of whatever is currently being output over here if both J and K are set and the clock goes high. But it's fine if the clock stays high, because this second latch is not going to be enabled. If the clock is high, then when we invert it, this is going to be low, these AND gates are both going to be off, this latch is not going to be active, and so this output will stay stable. So it doesn't matter if the clock stays high for whatever period of time, this first latch will switch, but the second one won't, until the clock goes low. Once the clock goes low, then that second latch enables, and the output of the first latch gets fed into the second latch, so whether that was setting it or resetting it. And then when that second latch either sets or resets, that's when the final output changes. And of course, at that point, if the output changes, it doesn't matter what's getting fed into the first stage over here, because, you know, our clock is low at this point. And so these AND gates are both going to be off, and so nothing is going to change here. So this circuit essentially has the exact same behavior as the first circuit that we were looking at, except that we don't have this issue of trying to make sure this pulse is so narrow that we don't have this racing where, you know, the output toggles and then it toggles again and toggles again and toggles again over and over, because we're not trying to use an RC circuit to create a pulse out of our clock. We're, you know, using the fact that the clock goes high to set one latch, and then when the clock goes low to set the next latch based on the first latch. And that way our feedback, you know, can't get back around to the input until you have a full clock cycle. And so this way, this will only toggle once per clock cycle. And we don't have to deal with any of the, you know, really stringent timing requirements, you know, where we're looking at this, you know, 40 millisecond propagation time and so forth. So I've gone ahead and built this circuit, the Masterslave JK flip-flop. And just like last time, I've got the two inputs here. This is our J and our K input. And again, they're, you know, tied low through this pull-down resistor, but then when you push the button, it goes high. And so those two inputs go into, this is again our three-input AND gates. So both of the inputs go into the two AND gates. And then this white wire is connecting our clock, and so we'll connect our clock into that. And then, of course, the third input is the feedback that comes back around, and that's these two green wires here. And then the output of these AND gates are the two blue wires that go up to our first two NOR gates, which are the top two NOR gates on this 74LS02. And then, you know, the outputs of those are connected back to the inputs of these two yellow wires, and then the outputs of those come to these first two LEDs. So these two LEDs here give us a way to see what's going on at this point here. So this is our, you know, our Q complement for the first stage, and this is our Q for the first stage. Then those outputs go over here to another, or I guess this is a 74LS08, so just a two input AND gates. And also connected to those AND gates is our clock. Except this time the clock is coming, so this is our original clock. It's going over to a 74LS04 inverter, and then coming out of that inverter and going into the AND gates here. And then the outputs of those AND gates go back to our 74LS02, our NOR gates, and here we're using the bottom two NOR gates for these. And so that is, yeah, that's these blue wires. The blue wires are, the blue wires are here, coming out of our AND gate, going into our NOR gates, right? So that's those two blue wires. And then, of course, we've got these two yellow wires. These two short yellow wires are the crossovers here between our inputs and outputs of the NOR gates. And then the outputs of the NOR gates are these two yellow wires that go over to our two LEDs. And so this is our Q, our final Q output, and this is our Q complement output. So let's hook it up to power and see what happens. So I'm going to hook into the power on our clock that I've got running over here. And so the first thing you see is, of course, looks like Q complement is on our first stage, and then of course Q complement is on our second stage. And if I hook a clock up here, okay, nothing happens, but I should be able to set and reset it. So if I hit J, that should set it. So Q should go high. And in fact, it does. Of course, you see Q goes high first on our first stage and then our second stage. And then if I reset it, it resets. And the other thing that I'll show you is if I put our clock into manual mode, so here I can just manually activate the clock that way. What you'll see is if I go ahead and try to, let's see, if I want to set this, so I turn on the J input, and of course nothing's happening because our clock's not doing anything. When the clock goes high, you see the first stage changes, and then it's when the clock goes low, the second stage changes, and now, you know, I've set the output by inputting a 1 on our J input and toggling the clock high then low. So this is a JK flip-flop, it should toggle, so if I give a 1 on both inputs, and actually I'll just let the clock run, you see with each clock pulse, each time the clock goes high, the first one toggles, each time the clock goes low, the second one toggles. And so if you just look at this bottom left LED, that's our Q output of our flip-flop, and you see it's just going high, low, high, low. It's toggling, which is exactly what we'd expect. And of course, because we don't have any of the, you know, crazy timing requirements here, this is going to work very consistently. We're not going to have any of the, you know, flakiness issues that I was having with the JK flip-flop that was using this RC circuit to try to detect the rising edge of the clock. And in fact, because it's much more reliable, this is this master-slave arrangement for building a JK flip-flop is typically the way that JK flip-flops are built in practice. So now that you understand how the JK flip-flop works, in future videos, rather than building JK flip-flop from all these components, we can go ahead and use a pre-packaged JK flip-flop, in this case the 74LS76, which is a dual master-slave JK flip-flop. So it's got two, that's what makes it a dual, there's two of them. And of course, master-slave JK flip-flop, you know what that means, that's what we just talked about. And so if you look at the flip-flop here, you see it's got, you know, of course, the J input and the K, oh no, here it is, the K input. I don't know why it goes all the way around there, but so you've got your J input, your K input, your Q output, your complementary Q output, so that's what it means, complementary output, as both a Q and the inverted Q outputs. And this one also has a preset and a clear. And so the preset and clear are these two other inputs that basically just force it to either set or reset. So rather than, it kind of bypasses the clocking mechanism, and so you can just force it to reset or reset. So that's just kind of another little feature that these have. And then the other thing you'll notice is the clock input here, it says it's inverted. It has this little bubble here. And that's actually absolutely correct, because this is a master-slave JK flip-flop. And you remember that the final output, the Q output, doesn't actually change until the clock, you know, both goes high and then goes low. And so unlike this first JK flip-flop that we tried to build that triggers on the rising edge of the clock, the master-slave JK flip-flop, because it requires the clock to go high and then low again, the output triggers on the falling edge of the clock. And so that's indicated in the symbol for it with this little bubble here showing that this is a, you know, this clock input is looking at the falling edge, is what that bubble means. So in the next video, I think we'll hook a couple of these 74LS76s together and build a binary counter.